you very much for inviting me. It's really, really nice to be here, and I'm very sorry about not making it in December and also the previous times. So it's not that I'm hard to get, it's just that I'm not very efficient about my time, so everything gets kind of messed up. So I believe you've been watching, you watched a film yesterday on Chhattisgarh, and it was about the Chhattisgarh Mukti Morcha, or?
The development paradigm in
Chhattisgarh. Okay, let me just start with, sorry that there are no loudspeakers, so you won't get the full effect, but maybe you can just play the film. So it's kind of self-explanatory. So if you, are you heard of Messenger of God, that Baba Gurmeet Ram Rahim Singh Insan, right? So you can actually just go online and check out his trailer for MSG2. And I don't know if any of you have like your phones here or whatever that you're online, but it's worth checking out because it's, so it has Baba Gurmeet Singh with his like, you know, dhumdhang, etc. He comes in and then there are like Adivasi, Shaitan hai, unko Atankwad hai, unko marna padega, and then there's like him battling against lots of people playing drums, and you know, it's a really, really racist kind of film where Baba says that, you know, ye to na janwar hai na insaan, ye to shaitan hai shaitan, right? So I encourage you all to actually go online and see this film, see this trailer. So somebody filed a case, somebody called Prem Singh Mardi, filed a case against this film in the Delhi High Court, saying that, you know, it was violative of their rights and so on. And the High Court ruled that because there was no such category called Adivasi in the Constitution, there was only scheduled tribes. So therefore, it did not violate any kind of provision of the Constitution, so the case was dismissed. Now, if you look at the making of the Constitution itself, there were, how much have you read about the Constitution? As in terms of what are the provisions for scheduled tribes or, okay. So, so basically when the Constitution was made,
so at the time the Constitution was made, the way that it was actually, came into being through the Constituent Assembly, there was a clause in the Cabinet Mission Plan which said that there will be a special committee to, apart from all the people who were in the Constituent Assembly, there will be a special committee to look into the rights of minorities, people belonging to what were then, it used to be called the excluded and partially excluded areas, what are now called scheduled areas. And so the Cabinet Mission Plan said the Advisory Committee on the Rights of Citizens, Minorities and Tribal and Excluded Areas should contain full representation of the interests affected, and their function will be to report to the Union Constituent Assembly upon the list of fundamental rights, the clauses for the protection of minorities, and a scheme for the administration of the tribal and excluded areas, and to advise whether these rights should be incorporated in the provincial group or union constitution. So there was supposed to be full representation of tribes, but actually there were only 6 members from the scheduled tribes who were in the Constituent Assembly. And Jaipal Singh, have you heard of Jaipal Singh? Yeah? How many people have heard of him? Okay, so Jaipal Singh was India's first first major Olympic player, right? He was the captain of the Indian Olympic hockey team in 1928 when they won the Olympics. He was a Munda from Ranchi district. He was came from an ordinary family, went to St. Paul's School, Ranchi, and was then taken by the principal of his school to England, where the principal retired. And then he was sent to Oxford, where he played for the university, and then because he played so well and was really getting well known, he was asked to captain the Indian Olympic hockey team. Now this was the first time that there was an Indian hockey team at all going to the Olympics at all. So anyway, so they won the Olympics and they came back, and he was a big hero, and he worked in many, he was married to the granddaughter of W.C. Banerjee, who was the president of the Indian National Congress. He worked in Burma Shell. He worked in as finance minister of Bikaner State, principal of Rajkumar College, Raipur. So he was very much in the kind of upper echelons of colonial society at that time. So he, in 1938, went back to Jharkhand, and people said, so what are you doing for your own people? And then he became president of the Adivasi Mahasabha. So Jaipal Singh was the only voice in the Constituent Assembly which was consistently talking about tribal issues. There were six other people, but one of them, there was a complaint that he paid 50,000 and got Kulban Shah, who was a Jagirdar from Central Provinces. So there was a representation from the Central Provinces Adivasis saying that he paid 50,000 and got himself elected to the Constituent Assembly. And he doesn't know how to read or write. He can only raise his hand and be a yes man. There were other people who were representatives, but who never really said anything. So Jaipal Singh kept insisting that this representation of six people was not what was promised. They had to have more. He also said that the word should be, in the constitution, should not be Janjati, but should be Adivasi. So he kept insisting that, you know, we refer to ourselves as Adivasis. We refer to, we have, our movement has called ourselves Adivasi, so why are you changing the name to Janjati in the Hindi translation of the constitution? So had Jaipal Singh been listened to, perhaps, you know, it would not have been so easy for the High Court to dismiss Prem Shankar Mahadevi's petition. So at the time that the Constituent Assembly was made, there were many representations that came from all over India, from different communities, but especially when you look at the fifth and sixth schedules, they came from tribal communities asking for all sorts of things. They said we should have more representation in the Constituent Assembly, we should have proportional representation instead of first past the post, we should have separate electorates, we need funds for education, lots of things. But in the end, what they got was very similar to the provisions of the 1935 Act, which were framed certain areas as excluded and partially excluded. And in fact, the 1935 Act was much more progressive because it allowed the governor of the state to decide whether the laws that were applied to other parts of the province should be applied to them or not. Right? However, in the constitution, under the fifth schedule, all the laws which are applicable to the rest of the state are also automatically applicable to tribal areas. How familiar are you with the fifth schedule? What are the areas of the fifth schedule? What are the areas of the sixth schedule? Any idea? No? Okay. So the fifth schedule applies to nine states in mainland India. So, Chhattisgarh, Madhya Pradesh, Maharashtra. So Gadchiroli is, parts of Gadchiroli are a fifth scheduled area. Bastar is a fifth scheduled area. Kashipur in Odisha, that's a fifth scheduled area. Adilabad, all of those, I mean parts of them, districts within them. And then in the Northeast you have the sixth schedule. So sixth schedule gives people much more powers than the fifth schedule gives. And the idea was that, for instance, land laws which allow land to be sold freely. You know, anyone can sell land to anybody else in Bombay, right? There is no prohibition. Whereas under the fifth schedule, you have laws that allow for special laws. So the idea that, okay, laws that are applicable to the rest of the state will not be applicable to fifth schedule areas, so that you can have special land laws for these fifth schedule areas. And Adivasis can only sell to other Adivasis. They cannot sell to non-tribals. The idea is to prevent Adivasi land being alienated, taken over by money lenders, outsiders coming in to settle. Now, obviously, there are lots and lots of ways in which people have circumvented this. They have taken over Adivasi land. And especially if you look at areas where industries are coming up, you find that a lot of non-outsiders are buying Adivasi land, or at least buying the land from scheduled castes and OBCs in that area, because there are a lot of other settlers as well. So one thing in the fifth schedule was that you could actually have separate laws for these areas. The other thing was that you would Rights Advisory Council, which was supposed to be a council of elected scheduled tribe representatives in the legislature, which would advise the government on what kind of policies to implement. So initially, in the draft prepared by the subcommittee, in which Jaipal Singh was an active member, they said that it will be the duty of that subcommittee to make recommendations. So that means the subcommittee consisting of tribal members can actually propose policies, they can, you know, say this is what we find wrong, etc. In the final constitution, if you look at it today, it says the governor may refer whatever they or she or he feels fit to the tribes advisory council, and their duty is to respond, and it's a purely consultative position, right? So from being in a situation of power where they can actively, proactively make suggestions, it was reduced to simply a consultative provision, and the governor could or could not, need or need not, you know, refer files, refer issues to the Tribes Advisory Council. Okay, can you go to the next? So part of this reason why, you know, the Tribes Advisory Council, the powers of it were whittled down, was because the people at that time, people like A.M. Munshi, who were on the right wing, you know, of the Congress Party, felt that tribes would not be able to cope with complex legislation, and so they should not be allowed to decide whether or not certain principles should be applied to their area. So they should not be allowed to decide whether forests in how the forests in their region should be governed. They should not be allowed to, you know, decide on law and order issues in their area. So this is actually a very old trope in Indian history, going back to the burning of the Khanda forest. You know, from the Mahabharata, when the whole forest was burned, and there's a lovely poem by Arun Kolatkar. Have you come across this poetry anywhere? Well, it's a long poem called Sarpa Satra, where he describes the burning of the Khanda forest and how all the animals were burned, So he asked, why did they do it? Why did they burn the forest? And says, and I'm quoting from the poem, children of the forest who had lived there happily for generations since time began. They've gone without a trace, with their language that sounded like the burbling of a brook, their songs that sounded like the twittering of birds, and the secrets of their shamans who could cure any sickness by casting spells, with their special flutes made from the hollow wing bones of red-crested cranes. Why did they do it? Why did they burn the forest? Who knows? Just for kicks, maybe. Maybe the fact that they now had all these fantastic weapons went to their heads, and they just couldn't wait to test their awesome powers. Maybe they just wanted a clear title to the land, unchallenged by so much as a tiger moth. Next slide, please. Can you go down? So this is actually not unique to India. It's part of a long history of colonial genocides against indigenous people, where in order to justify clearing the land or killing people, you'd have to paint them as savages, right? Even now when you see riots or massacres, it's possible because the other person is so dehumanized. You don't even see them as human beings like yourself, so it's possible to kill them, it's possible to take their land, because they are savage, they are undeserving, and so therefore it's your civilizational duty to get rid of them. That's the kind of long history of colonial racism and also within the Indian caste system. And so this photo from the bottom is actually of a Maoist woman from in 2009 being taken out by CRPF after an encounter. So, you know, the way that you can see the dehumanizing, the treating her like an animal, that, you know, she's carried out the way that animals are carried out after a hunt. There's also a lot of next slide, please. No, yeah. This is from a tourism website of the Bastar district tourism website. So people protested and then it got taken down. But you can see again the way that the administration also thinks about that area, right? That they are not clean, that they like drinking, they like free sex. And this is complete rubbish. Marriage with the wives of the brothers and between brothers and sisters are common. So there's ignorance, there's racism, there's an obsessive interest with sex, which you find about a lot among people who are kind of denigrating tribals. And for instance, again, the dehumanization, the similarities to making them seem like animals. When drinking from a stream, they do not take up water in their hands but put their mouths down to it like cattle. Right? So again, this is something that is being, and actually this is replicated again and again in Supreme Court, in High Court judgments, like that Prem Bharati judgment, which said that, you know, there was nothing to worry about. This is from a Supreme Court judgment saying that they should, you know, should they not be encouraged to seek greener pastures elsewhere if they can have access to it, either through their own efforts due to information exchange or due to outside compulsion. So the idea that, next please. This is again the idea that if people are not willing to leave their lands and get developed on their own, they should be forced to do it at gunpoint, right? So the whole civilizing impulse is actually enforced through force. This is actually an ad on Republic Day. Next, please. So just to give you a little background on what the composition of the scheduled tribes is, we're talking about a significant percentage of India's population, 8.6%, of which some communities are very, very large, Santhals, Oraos, etc. And then you have much smaller communities like the the Onge, what are called, particularly vulnerable tribal groups. So, so there's actually no reason why these particular communities, I mean, there is a reason, but that reason is a bit circular. So, the official reason says that we are describing those scheduled tribes as scheduled tribes who are scheduled under Article 342. While 342 says whoever has been notified by the president. So there is no, I mean, it's a completely administrative classification as to who gets scheduled and who doesn't get scheduled. So another issue is that there are many people who are not scheduled, who are asking to be scheduled because they suffer from the same kinds of disabilities. There are people who are scheduled who are living outside the scheduled area, so they don't have the same kind of protection. And there are people living inside the scheduled areas who perhaps should not have that protection and are in the scheduled area. So the lists are state specific. So if you're a scheduled tribe in one state, you're not necessarily in another state. So for instance, many of the scheduled tribes who migrated from Chhattisgarh or Jharkhand to Assam are no longer scheduled tribes in Assam. They're just called E-tribes or they don't have any. Can you hear me at the back? Next please. So one of the criteria specified for describing somebody as a schedule through various committees was distinctive culture, geographical isolation, shyness of contact, backwardness. Now if you look at distinctive culture, every single community in this country has a distinctive culture. People who wear pagdis and go on horses to ride to their weddings are also very peculiar compared to other people who don't. Like in the south, we get married in the morning, in the north, you get married in the evening, in the middle of the night, in the west, they get married. So everybody is highly peculiar, highly, so this idea that Adivasis somehow are peculiar in their culture is just so denigratory in terms of the way that the conceptual scheme is. Similarly, in terms of geographical isolation, most communities are not at all geographically isolated. They are perfectly well integrated. So it's a way, in a way, that whole, can you go down? Classification is problematic. So let's look at quickly the formal constitutional provisions. I sat on my specs yesterday and wrote them, so it's a bit, I'm a bit kind of out of focus about everything. Okay, so, so these are all constitutional provisions that you have scheduled areas, you have Article 342, you have laws against land alienation, you have post-independence also certain, next please, laws that came into being like the Panchayats Extension to Scheduled Areas Act, which and so on. And then next is, you have reservations for all STs and SCs. Again, you know, both in government services, which, and some of that is seriously under threat today. For instance, with this recent Supreme Court judgment, which said that allowed the state of Uttarakhand not to have reservations, saying that it's a decision of the state whether or not to have. So it's not even dependent on any data that they have to get, it's just their decision whether or not to have. Next please. However, let's look at the state of indicators. So on the one hand, you have all of these provisions in the constitution. On the other hand, you have horrible, horrible indicators. So there's a huge gap between the Human Development Index of STs and the All India figure. Child mortality rates are higher. 46% of women have a body mass index of less than 18%, which is basically chronic starvation. So what does that mean actually? What does it mean to be at a stage of chronic starvation? It means, for instance, I had a friend who had a stomach ache. She had a stomach ache for a long time, and we went to the doctor. This was in a village in Bastar, and he checked her hemoglobin level. It was 4. The normal, at least for a woman, should be, you know, around 11 or something, and she had a hemoglobin level of 4, but she was going to the forest, collecting fuel wood, bringing water, working in the fields. So it means that people with body mass indexes of 18.5 and that kind of low level starvation are actually working at much, much more than their capacity. Think of yourselves as just working, feeling tired all the time, but just working. And it's this kind of labor that we are really dependent on to get so many products. So the wood that these benches are built on, the chocolates that you eat, they're made of sal. The oil in them is from sal seeds, which are collected by village women. You know, tanning your shoes, that again comes from the forest. Harra, behra, all of these are sort of medicinal herbs, again coming from the forest. So, I mean, you look around you, any product that you're using has something that comes from the labor of people who are basically have been reduced to chronic starvation. And that is the whole structure of the country, that people who have nothing are the ones who are enabling social mobility. Or you look at people who are on doing construction work on the roads or making brick kilns. Now, all those brick kilns in Odisha, Andhra, all of them mostly come from tribal labor in Jharkhand or Odisha, right? So no construction work would be possible in this country without that kind of labor. And why is that kind of labor happening? Because people are being dispossessed, because there's great If you look at just a comparison between SCs and STs, that in a way they both suffer from racism and stigma, but they have different, slightly different kinds of problems. So for instance, among SCs you have manual scavenging, which is completely inhuman. And despite the Supreme Court, I mean, the case went to the Supreme Court and they ordered compensation, but they haven't, I mean, people are not supposed to have manual scavenging, right? But that continues in all our cities. Landlessness, again, land elimination is similar. However, if you look at other issues, like Adivasis have a big issue with language, because their languages are not recognized, they're not taught, whereas Dalits are part of the same, you know, language system as the state where they live. And so there are slightly different, I mean, they suffer from similar kinds of disabilities, but also slightly different, which are important to them. So what are the, so we have the constitutional provisions for protection, and then what are the real provisions that are governing Adivasi lives, right? Which is the Land Acquisition Act, the Mines and Minerals Act, the Gold Bearing Areas Act, the Penal Code. And these are the, next please. So these are the real issues that are taking away the protection that Adivasis supposedly have in the constitution. The various laws governing resources. And so the main concerns are uncertain areas of landlessness, lack of forest rights, displacement, state repression, education, and health. Next please. So if you look at displacement, again, the burden has predominantly fallen on Adivasis. 1 in 40% of those displaced are Adivasis, which means basically 1 in 4 families, 1 in 4 are actually displaced. Next slide. So if you, let's look at the last 100 years, there have been at least 3 significant waves of displacement. One is forest reservation, which has now led to the Forest Rights Act. There have been displacement by large dams. And then mining has been the third biggest wave, starting from the early 2000s till now. I mean, there was mining before also, but it's really intensified now. And you can see that this really overlaps with what is so-called red borders. So one of the reasons why the Land Acquisition Act was changed in 2013 was because of constant issues of displacement, people protesting against displacement, being fired upon by the police. And so, you know, just from 2001 till now, we have like so many cases where people 14 killed in one case in Nandigram, 9 killed in Dantara, Chakar, and so on. And almost all of them are Adivasis. Can you go down further? So to come back to that left, that red corridor, whatever, right? The government solutions to it. So they talk about security and development. But if you look at the money that is being spent on security versus the kind of money that is being spent on development, security is way out of proportion to anything that is being spent on development. And what does security count as? It's not about the security of ordinary people, because people feel scared. If you had a CRPF camp come up outside your college, and the CRPF kind of lounge around and bathe, etc., then I doubt that any of you would feel highly secure, right? But somehow, village people are expected to feel secure because they have these camps coming up, and women are saying that, you know, we can't even go into the jungles to shit anymore because there are like soldiers roaming around. What can we do? We can't bathe because in our village, because there are people hanging around. So nobody feels secure, but that is the state's idea of security, that you have these camps coming up all over the place. You have roads being built which are supposed to be like, you know, 6-lane highways, and helicopters. So in places like Bastar, where now for the last 15 years there's been intense militarization, you have a huge amount of money on propaganda, on roads. Can you go down, please? Yeah. So these are from being an area which was completely people were just conducting their agriculture and fuel work and forest connection, etc. Now you have camps every 2 to 5 kilometers, you have these anti-mine vehicles, you have 6, you know, like huge highways that are being built. All the police stations are surrounded with barbed wire. How much do you want me to talk about the Naxalite issue in Bastar? How much do you know, or how interested are you in? You are aware? So actually, a lot of this started in 2005. So the Naxalites had been there from 1980 onwards, really. And they came through, most of them came from Andhra, the top leadership, and then now 90% of the people are local cadres. And what they've been doing in the villages from, so initially when they came, they were like little Robin Hoods. They would go around like threatening the forest guard, like don't come and, you know, arrest people for cutting fuel wood or pay minimum wages, etc. Then gradually they began to build sangams in each village. So sangams are like your union. They are elected bodies that each village has. So 2 people will look after forest, 2 people will look after something else. And so they had a whole network in the villages. In 2005, the government started a counterinsurgency operation called Salva Jalom, which basically told people that if you don't come and join us on our rallies against the Maoists, then we will burn your villages. We will. So many people were forced to come and live in camps. Many people fled into the forest, people fled to Andhra. And since then the Maoists also retaliated, number of killing of informers went up, and there's been a huge loss of life since then. hundreds of villages have been burnt. From 2005 onwards, people, you know, fled, and slowly after 2009, they began to come back. So now, most people are back in their villages, but, you know, they've got no compensation, they've rebuilt their lives of their own. In 2011, the Supreme Court banned Sarvajgurum and they ordered compensation, etc., but the government has done nothing. Till date, the government has not given compensation to people for the burning. They've not collected figures on how many people killed. They're not allowing us to collect figures, etc. So Sudha Bhardwaj is, you know, one of the people who, she had actually filed a petition and they got some compensation from the NHRC recently, but, you know, people like her are in jail. Okay, so since, so now the situation is that you have these barbed wire camps every 5 kilometers. Supposedly normalcy is coming back, but people continue to feel insecure, they continue to be encounters, and then you see. So can you come to the education section? Yeah. So just to, I just want to talk a bit about education and how it affects people. We know that there are lots and lots of languages which are dying out because you know, there are less than 10,000 speakers of those languages, and each language actually contains a lot of information about the world. So for instance, Inuits, what we call Eskimos, have like 20 different words that they use for snow. Have you read this lovely book by Anupam Mishra called Rajasthan Ke Rajat Boonde? It's about the different words for raindrops that they have in Rajasthan. Because they get so little rain, each drop of rain is precious. So there are words for like fat raindrops and words for that thin drizzle. Right? You know the different kinds of types of raindrops that you get. So if these languages die out, we're actually losing a huge resource in terms of knowledge about the environment, in terms of knowledge about history. And as you know, also knowledge of plant varieties and forest varieties. Next. And actually this is not just a loss to those communities, but a loss to the whole nation, to the whole world, because you know, this is a huge source of information. So for instance, we have 4,502 documentary agricultural practices, 40,000 different plant formulations that have come to us through these different systems of medicine, traditional harvesting practices, etc. Next, please. However, people persist, if you look at the textbooks, they persist in seeing Adivasis as backward, and you know, coming back to that tourism website, to the Supreme Court and High Court judgments, it's that whole idea that Adivasis are blamed for their own lack of education and progress. Next, please. So again, to look at the comparative literacy rates, next, please. So one of the issues is, of course, common to all communities. One is that the language issues are a problem. And the other problem is the fact that schools have been militarized. So schools are a common site of where, you know, in Bastar, the CRPF occupied the camps, then the Maoists blew up the schools. The CRPF occupied the schools because they were the only pakka building in the village. The Maoists blew them up. And since now, the last 10, 15 years, there are some areas where there has been no school at all. And people are then put into these 1,000-seater pota cabins, which are really scary for little children, right? If you are a 5-year-old, 6-year-old child, no parent wants to send them off to some like huge school where they get no attention and the children try and run away, and you know, it's really quite sad. So can you go down? No, go down, down, down. Down, further down, down. Yeah. So this is just from my school, which was occupied by the CRPF as a children located to the old school corridor. Next, please. School building demolished by now. About, you know, they're made to feel that their own culture is inferior, and they're told about, you know, that civilization lies in celebrating Hindu festivals or learning Sanskrit by the night. This is very similar to what happened in Australia with the Aboriginal children there or in Canada. Next. That's it. So I'll stop at that, and if there are any questions you want to ask about this or the Forest Rights Act or Maoism or how the constitution was made or anything else.
Long answer to your question.
Yeah.
Then the government started an authority for other ways of multilingual education, which they own private networks. So the education of the matters is that a dilemma?
How seriously are these multilingual education projects taken? I mean, that's one thing. How many? Yeah, but so there are several reasons. One is the lack of engagement in the schools. So language is one issue, but the quality of good textbooks. Even, I mean, this is actually there was a probe report some years ago about why poor children are not going to school. One argument is that they, you know, the standard argument is they're not interested in education, or their parents are forcing them to do labor, etc. But what the probe report found was that supply side issues were also a big problem, because you know, school is boring. In our class also, in our MA sociology class, half the students don't come. So it's not like because they're poor or they're doing bonded labor, they just find us boring, right? So if you think about school as a, or they have better things to do in their life, I really don't know what. Is attendance compulsory? No? Yes. Well, whatever, right? So if you look, it's not just a problem with adivasi children, but a general supply side problem with schooling. Also, the cost of, even if the fees are there, you know, textbooks, school uniforms, all of those add up. The other thing is that, you know, there's huge migration out of these tribal areas now because of the kind of lack of resources, displacement, etc., which means that parents are basically working somewhere else. So either the children go with them or they stay with their grandparents. And so there are all sorts of complex issues which is still worth exploring. Does the land acquisition act override the right? Yeah, so there is the land acquisition allows land to be acquired. And one of the problems is that it does, as you say, override the fifth schedule, because once the land is acquired by the government, it has been giving it to for ancillary industries and onto non-tribals. So it's a way of bypassing the land alienation laws. There was a Samta judgment which said that even government should be treated as a non-tribal. So if the government acquires land for mining, it can only be by the state mining corporation and has to be used, the benefits from that have to go to tribal things. But Samta judgment is not being observed. So that is partly the problem, that on the one hand you have the fifth schedule, on the other hand you are treating it like every other area through IPC, Land Acquisition Act, etc.
Also the Samta
judgment
was by the High Court, a lot of other states have done that.
Yeah, it was for Andhra specifically,
yeah,
so it
doesn't.
It was by the Supreme Court, but they applied it only to Andhra.